Let's get to Robert Barnes. He is a Supreme Court reporter for The Washington Post, and he joins me now from Washington. Good to see you.
Nice to see you.
So, Robert, walk us through the substance of these meetings between a Supreme Court nominee and members of the Senate. What sorts of things get discussed in those sit-downs?
Well, the senators try to get them to get specific, and the nominees try to remain general and evasive, is generally what happens. You know, the senators would like to know the answers to specific questions and ways that the nominees might rule if they're on the Supreme Court. The nominees try very hard to stay away from those kind of things, that it is something they say they shouldn't do on issues that are going to come before the court. And so in many ways, it is sort of a personality thing. It's whether or not the folks get along, and generally how intelligent they feel that the nominees are on the Constitution and the law.
So, Robert, clearly the Republicans have a majority in the Senate, but the Democrats have talked about perhaps filibustering this pick. There's a great article in your newspaper today. It's titled On the Death of the Senate and Its Long History as the World's Greatest Deliberative Body. It's written by your colleague Paul Kane. And in it, there's a discussion of what many people are calling the nuclear option. Explain that for our viewers, what that is.
Well, generally, things require 60 votes, or they can require 60 votes in the Senate to move to the next step and to actually have a vote on something. The Democrats, when they were in control, got rid of that for lower court judicial nominations, appeals courts, federal district courts, and said that only a majority is needed. That rule is still in place for Supreme Court nominees, meaning that you really need 60 votes in order to move ahead to a final vote on a nominee. But the Democrats, Republicans are now saying, you know, the Democrats got rid of it. If they don't cooperate with us on this, we might have to do the same thing on Supreme Court nominations.
You know, a lot of people are saying, a lot of people who've been in Washington for many, many years, that they haven't seen it this contentious in the Senate and in the Congress for many years, perhaps going back to the early 60s. And even during that period of time, there was some bipartisan agreement on things like, for example, the 1964 Civil Rights Act. After Senate Democrats refused to attend the votes on two of the president's confirmations, Senator Pat Toomey of Pennsylvania said this: "We did not inflict this kind of obstructionism on President Obama." How do you react to that?
Well, you know, there is a lot of hypocrisy on both sides when it gets to these partisan matters. I think really in judicial nominations, that's where you hear it the most. These are not supposed to be partisan decisions. These are not supposed to be partisan judges. But I think a real danger for the courts is that they have become that, where all the Democrats are on one side, all the Republicans are on the other, depending on the party of the president that nominated the judicial candidate. Chief Justice John Roberts has talked about this and the real dangers. And he says that the last three justices, Justice Alito from the Republican side, Justices Sotomayor and Kagan from the Democratic side, were voted on pretty much on party line votes, although all of them got more than 60, I believe. And he thinks that's a real danger for the court.
So let's talk about Judge Gorsuch and his ideology. He's been compared to the late Justice Antonin Scalia in that both see the Constitution, or they are both originalists. What does that mean?
It means that they try to interpret the Constitution the way those who wrote it thought at the time, that you try to look for the original meaning of the words of the Constitution and what that allows and what it doesn't allow. You know, a sort of close corollary to this is called textualism, meaning that you look at laws passed by Congress only by looking at the text of what is there, not what Congress may have intended or how what the consequences of would be of changing that or interpreting it in a different way. And so, you know, there really is only one other originalist, true originalist on the Supreme Court now, and that's Justice Clarence Thomas, who took it probably even more serious than Justice Scalia did. The other Republican-appointed justices, though, are textualists, and they talk about originalism, but you couldn't call them originalists.
So then how would his confirmation impact the balance of the court? You see it... go ahead.
I'm sorry. It in a way, it returns the court to what we had before, which is a court with five members appointed by Republican presidents, generally conservative, four Democratic-appointed justices who are liberal. But one of those five justices, Justice Kennedy, is really the middle of the court. On any big sort of social issue that comes before the court, Justice Kennedy is pretty much needed for one side to prevail over the other.
And in fact,
sometimes.
I was going to say, in fact, you wrote in the Washington Post this morning that this court remains Justice Kennedy's court. And I guess that's what you're essentially saying, which is that he will be that moderate who will sway the court when it comes to some of these big decisions.
That's exactly right. About two thirds of the time on these issues, Justice Kennedy votes with his Republican conservative colleagues. But in some very important cases, last term affirmative action, restrictions on abortion, before that same-sex marriage, Justice Kennedy was with the liberals.
Robert Barnes of The Washington Post, thank you, sir. We appreciate the time.
My pleasure.